I don't know. I don't know what kind of programming in general is being done by Hollywood studios for interactive, but I think Star Trek lends itself to interactive. Star Trek is a vehicle that fans have been attracted to and have wanted to interact with in one way or another for the last 26 to 27 years. The technology now makes it possible for them to really do that. We've had over the years Star Trek attractions at theme parks around the country, for example, where a small group at a time of young people would be put into Star Trek uniforms, get on a stage and act out a line or two with a group of other actors, and then have themselves injected into a Star Trek videotape that they can take home and show their family. Here I am with Mr. Spock, here I am with Captain Kirk, or whatever. Saying this line or that, there I am, you know, that kind of thing. So there's always been, for many years, that kind of desire. Everybody knows that there have been hundreds and hundreds of Star Trek conventions over the years, and people come out to meet and talk about Star Trek and exchange ideas about Star Trek and watch Star Trek episodes and films together over and over again until they know the dialogue well enough to read it back to the TV set. To listen to speakers who have had anything to do with Star Trek. If anybody who's been a visitor on the set of Star Trek has become a celebrity in his hometown. There's a tremendous need to interact with these people because we are presenting a world that touches the imagination. We're presenting a positive future world that a lot of people would like to be in touch with. And I think now the technology makes it possible for them to really feel that they are involved in a very real physical way with the story that's playing itself out in an interactive process. The appeal of entertainment on CD-ROM is the switch from passive to active. Instead of switching channels to see another show, you go to work on this one and change the program, change the course of the event of the plot. From an actor's point of view, it's a process of making it all work through vocal work. We are not involved physically on camera in this particular program. On the other hand, it's a little bit more complicated because each line has to serve, each reading of each line of dialogue has to serve a number of purposes because the story could diverge from that line on into different directions depending on what the viewer chooses the plot to go to. I think that we have a big advantage in that having played these characters and having lived with these characters for a long period of time, we tend to know how the character would respond in certain situations. If we were in the process of creating a new character, I think it would be more difficult. I think we'd have to do more research, more study, more discussion about, well, how's the character going to act if he's in trouble? How's the character going to act when he gets out of trouble? We know the answers to those questions. We've been with these characters for a long time. We know the relationships between the characters, the relationships between Spock and McCoy, McCoy and the captain and Spock, and then all the rest of us with Uhura and Scotty and Sulu and Cheka. We understand what these relationships are all about. They go on like a soft glove. You put it on and you go to work. So I think we have the advantage in that respect over other people who might have to be creating new characters for this medium. It seems to me that the incredible challenges are for the writers. Because the writers have to design and develop so many different tracks of the story. When you make a motion picture or an episode of television, you're creating one story track, and that's going to be the story that you tell. In this medium, you're creating several story tracks, and each of those story tracks can branch off into different directions, so it multiplies geometrically. And there's a lot more work to do, starting with the writing. A lot more work to do with the recording and the editing of all this material. It's quite an enormous task, very complicated. I don't know exactly what will be happening in theatrical interactive, but I think certainly in this process, in CD-ROM interactive, it's going to be light years ahead of the theatrical interactive, if it ever happens theatrically, because I think the cost of doing it theatrically would be too enormous. So I think this is the ideal medium for it. I can't say I was really surprised. I thought this has been some time in coming, and certainly his time has come. Our stories lend themselves to this kind of imaginative adventure. The plot lines that can be created in this kind of a process are I think excitingly obvious. I thought, well, here it is. We've been hearing about all these various means of delivering information, of capturing information on a disk, and the quality moving so quickly, the technology moving so quickly. I'm not surprised. I'm not surprised we're here doing it. We seem to be in exactly the right place at the right time, doing exactly the right thing. I would think they'll feed each other. I would think that that Star Trek, the original classic episodes, as well as the Next Generation episodes, will be running on television for the rest of time that we know, and I would think that that the interactive will lead people to be interested in the original episodes and vice versa. I'm not sure about that. I do believe that interactive in a purely theatrical situation where people pay a price to walk into a theater and sit down will have certain limitations. I think the cost of producing interactive films, I think there have been some experiments which have not been too gloriously successful, where audiences vote on how the next scene should be played or how the story should evolve from here. I'm not sure that that's what people want when they pay their $7 or $6 or $5 or $4, whatever they pay, to sit down in a theater and watch a story. I think they do go for a collective experience where everybody experiences the same story. On the other hand, I think it's very exciting in terms of use of computer technology at home, for the interactive we're talking about specifically. I do believe that, there are times when I or my children or grandchildren are watching television and flipping through the channels, and you go through now, if you have cable television and you subscribe to some services, you might have 20 channels, I guess, or maybe 25 or even 30 channels, and somebody shuts off the TV and says, well, there's nothing on. Amazing. What we're really saying is there's nothing on that captures our imagination tonight. There's nothing on that we really must see. So perhaps what we're looking for is something that we want to do, something that we can affect, that rather than being passive, rather than sitting and watching stuff that somebody says is what we should be seeing tonight, maybe there's something that we want to get our hands on. Maybe we want to say, well, what would happen if this would go this way? Or what would happen if, let me work with that. Let me explore that. What's hidden in here? What are the secret tracks and avenues in here that I don't know about yet? That's, I think, is very exciting stuff. Very different from just turning on to see what's on. Turning it on to see what you can do with what's on, and what's hidden and what is not immediately obvious, but you discover for yourself, I think is a very exciting process. Well, yes, and using very professional visual techniques and using the professional actors who play these roles and guiding them through the adventure and watching them make mistakes that you've led them to and watching them solve problems that you've helped them solve by picking up certain clues and certain evidence, I think is a very exciting new experience. The possibilities for imaginative stories are endless. Much like in the animation business, and yet even far more complex and credible. As a person in my business, you become very much aware that anytime you create a story idea that has any imagination or size or canvas or scope to it, you are also creating budgetary issues. You're creating costs. Anytime you say, well, there are 1,000 people listening to a person do a speech and you want to shoot that scene, those 1,000 people are going to cost you a lot of money. So somebody in the budget department comes down and says, can you do with 100? Or can you do with 50? And everything starts to shrink down to what one can afford. Well, to draw the animation for the 1,000 may not cost much more, if anything, more than drawing the 50 and having them replicated 20 times, and you've got your 1,000 people. So the opportunity to tell larger stories, more exciting, more complex stories, to give more texture, to give more scope, more size, more mystery, more magic, the opportunities are endless. It just depends on how vivid the imagination is and how much energy you have to put into it as opposed to money to put into it. So in that respect, it's very exciting. You can do stories, you can develop ideas that might have been much too costly to do before this medium came along. I've had a good time with Star Trek and Spock over the years, and I consider myself very lucky to have become connected with a project that has had the lifespan that Star Trek has had. Did we know when we were making the original series that we would now be, 27, 28 years after going on the air, that we would still be around working the Star Trek territory? No, certainly not. Couldn't have predicted that. But I did know, I think I can honestly say, I did know when we were making the original episodes that there was a durable substance to what we were doing, because the stories had a certain kind of durability, a certain kind of integrity. We were dealing with issues which are eternal issues, not simply issues of today or this week. And we were not, I don't think, trendy. We were doing sort of classic ideas, dealing with large classic thematic ideas, social issues, territorial issues, issues of population, issues of hate, greed, vengeance, the very large passions that came down to us from the Greek drama, from ancient times. So I did feel that the stuff that we were doing was durable, as compared to some other television series of the day, which were more topical and maybe even hotter and more exciting and more popular at the time, but not anywhere near as durable. And for that reason, I find myself not surprised that we're still doing it. I'm very pleased that I've been connected with something that had that kind of longevity. We are now, in a way, seeing the same kind of technological revolution in entertainment that happened when sound came in and replaced talkies. It's just as great a step forward, greater even. Because you could sit and enjoy a movie even before sound, even before talkies. But now, I think the changes, the advancements are by great leaps and bounds today, as opposed to being able to walk instead of crawl. We are now able to take gigantic leaps technologically. To see some of the things that are being done in special effects these days by a lot of companies, instead of perhaps just one or two companies that are experimenting with and crudely performing certain kinds of what we at one time thought were wonderful special effects, now there are a lot of companies that are capable of doing it very quickly. They're mastering these techniques. Computers have given us the power, the electronic power, to do enormous accomplishments technologically. So I think we really are moving very, very quickly towards whatever the mind can imagine that we can accomplish. One of the things about Star Trek that has, I think, made it so successful is that we have portrayed a successful and exciting future for mankind. And I think that's what we're seeing now in the technology. The technology is leading us to that. I think CD-ROM is the next logical step in technological evolution, obviously. The difficulty for me in moving from acting to directing was that the first two movies that I made as a director, I was also performing in the film. So I was doing what a lot of other very successful and very talented people had done before, which is to act and direct in the same movie. Woody Allen has done it, Clint Eastwood has done it, Chaplin certainly did it, movie after movie. I found it particularly difficult to do. And one of the very simple reasons for the difficulty was that my makeup takes, when I do Spock, takes about 2 hours to put on. So in the morning, if the director had to be at work at 7 a.m., I had to get into a makeup chair at 5 a.m. to get my makeup done by 7 so that I could step out of the chair and start directing the movie. that would add 2 hours a day to what would be a long day anyway. It could be a 12 or 14 hour day and add 2 hours for makeup. You've got a 14 or 16 hour work day or longer sometimes. I'm much more comfortable doing either one or the other. And in fact, when we did Star Trek III, I worked very hard at designing a story where there was a minimal amount of Spock, frankly, in the movie, so that my first feature would be a little bit easier for me to direct and occasionally act. In Star Trek IV, I did a lot more on-camera work. And the movies that I've made since, I have avoided acting in for just that reason. I like both very, very much. I like acting and directing both. But for me, acting and directing on the same film is not a pleasure. It's a task. I'd rather do one or the other. That was the toughest part of the transition. The easiest part of the transition came because I have been around sets, movie sets, ever since the 50s. I've been at it for about 40 years. So I obviously have been around some very talented directors and watched a lot of very good people do the job and learn how to do it. The benefit that I had was that I had played Spock for many, many years before I stepped into this directing work. So I knew the character. It wasn't as though I was trying to create a new character and needed to look around to ask people, does this character work? You know? I pretty much knew what makes Spock tick by the time I started directing the Star Trek films. So that helped a lot. I was acting around. I was, as they say, around in the labor pool. In the 60s, I had done a lot of television, an occasional feature. Actually had been in the business for about 15 years. I did an episode, I did a guest starring episode of The Lieutenant. Guest starred portraying a movie actor in an episode of The Lieutenant, which was a Gene Roddenberry's series. And he was in the process of rounding up people to act in the pilot for Star Trek. And my agent called me. I never met Gene when I was making the show. He was away out of town somewhere, saw the show after it was finished shooting. My agent called me and said, I had a call from Gene Roddenberry. He says that he's developing a pilot for a television series, science fiction. He's interested in you, and you'll be hearing from him when he gets ready to cast. And I immediately put it totally out of mind. I thought, we're now talking about a guy who is developing a pilot, who thinks he has a role in that pilot that he might want to use me for. The pilot may never be shot in the first place. When it is, by the time it is shot, they'll probably change their mind six or eight times about who should act in it. And then his chances of being sold are almost nil. At that time, there were a lot of pilots made and very few were chosen, as they say. So I just put it out of mind. I'd been around long enough that I didn't put any stock in it. But sure enough, 3 or 4 or 5 months later, I was called to meet Gene Roddenberry at the studio. And I went to see him thinking that I was going to audition for a role. And when I got there, Gene started introducing me to a lot of department heads. This is our property department head. This is the person who's going to do our wardrobe. And I was looking at wardrobe designs. I was looking at props. I was taken to the stages and looked at sets. And I thought, they're going to shoot this thing. And I wonder when I'm going to be asked to read some scenes. And I never was. And he shook my hand and said, I hope you like what you've seen and we'll be in touch. And I thought, I think he's telling me he wants me to do this job. You know? And that's pretty much the way it happened. He had seen the work that I did in The Lieutenant. He had seen some other episodic television work that I had done. He had rounded up some other films that I had appeared in and made the decision that I should be the guy. The network was extremely leery of a recurring character who you would see a lot of in a television series who looked to them devilish and they thought frightening to an audience. It was really interesting. In those days, I'm talking about 1964, I think was the first pilot, the concept for making a pilot for a television series was you bring together a group of 3 or 4 or 5 principal actors and actresses, each of whom represent a segment of your potential audience. The male lead should be the guy that the father in the American family can I relate to and identify with. The female should be the lady that the mother in the family can relate to and identify with. The kid in the show should be the person who appeals to the kids in the audience, and preferably this family should have a pet. And the pet should be a typical dog or whatever that'll come when you call it and bring you your slippers, you know. It was the American family kind of concept. Here's this guy with the pointed ears. And the feeling was, who in the American audience is going to relate to him? How many people out there have pointed ears? How many people, aren't there going to be people who think this guy is scary and devilish? And they actually asked Gene Roddenberry to first replace me and change the character, and then at least take the pointed ears away. And after we shot the pilot, and there were some sales brochures printed up for the network publicity department and sales department to show to potential sponsors, to show them the story of the series, what it would be about, and what the characters would look like. Because I was in the pilot, I was on the mailing list, and I got one of these things in the mail. And I opened it, and I looked at it. And to my shock, my ears were round. I thought, what's wrong with this picture? There's something wrong here. My ears were perfectly rounded. And I called Gene, and I said, have you seen these photographs? He said, yes. And I said, what does this mean? And he explained to me that they were concerned about this character. And in order not to offend anybody in the potential audience or potential sponsors, they had changed the look of the character in the photographs. They had taken away the arched eyebrows and made them look normal and taken the points off my ears. And I thought, that's the end of me. Obviously, they don't want me or my character in this show. But Gene persisted. And within about 5 or 6 weeks after the show went on the air, the mail for Spock was so heavy that the network did a total turnaround, and they were now calling Gene Roddenberry and saying, put him in more scenes. We want to see more of him. So it caused some anguish for the writers because we were already shooting. And typically, at the end of Act 2 of a 3-act episode of Star Trek, the way they were constructing these things was, Captain Kirk would say, well, there's a problem on the planet. I'm going to go down and solve this problem now, which meant that he would go down and deal with the heavy or the creature or whatever it was for the last act, and we'd be sitting up on the Enterprise biting our nails like, is it going to be okay? And now, because the network had decided they wanted to see more of Spock, he'd say, I'm going down to the planet. Spock, you come with me. So I would go down and stand around on the planet and watch him take care of the heavy until the writers were able to catch up with what was happening and integrate us successfully. I would come down and be a spectator, kind of trying to help him, but not really written into the scene yet because the writers hadn't caught up with this idea. So that was the process, and gradually we found our way, and then the Dr. McCoy irritation, you know, McCoy and Spock being so different in personality. I used to say that McCoy and Spock, the two of them together, made a Kirk. You know, there was the logical side and the emotional side, and that was how the triangle kind of was structured. I think one of the wonderful things about the character, the way it was written and designed, was that it played to the audience's intelligence and appealed to the audience's intelligence. This is a bright character, and it makes people feel good that they get it. They understand how he's operating, how he's functioning. There's also another very, very important aspect of the Spock character, which is that he's half human, and he's fighting that all the time. He's trying to control that all the time. So you have this split and this tension, internal tension, between the logical, precise, rational, scientific Vulcan side and the emotional, human side. And I think that is a split that all of us humans understand about ourselves. We deal with these issues in everyday life. Should I get upset about this, or should I just try to work it through logically? That's a very human condition. Does this person hurt my feelings, or is there something here that I should I put that aside and deal with it in terms of what's the facts? What are we trying to accomplish here? Should I fly off the handle and act out, or just simply try to solve the problem? These are very human questions that we deal with every day. And My role in Interplay's game, obviously, is the character Spock, and a very classic role, very classic function, to help Captain Kirk solve problems, to provide information, to be a sort of a different point of view for him. He looks at a situation a certain way. I might say, Captain, you should be aware that such and such. Or, Captain, I have discovered that so-and-so. Here's some information. Captain, I have certain tools that I can offer you. I have the ability to read a person's mind. I have the ability to do a neck pinch on a person and render that person unconscious. I have the ability to function as a computer under certain situations. I have the ability to interpret scientific data for you. What would be useful to you? What would you like me to perform a function here that only a Vulcan or a scientist can perform? So in that way, it's very classic. Support the captain, help him solve problems, and be of as much use as I can be. I'm really very pleased with what Interplay's writers and designers have captured. I think that that the people who are designing these games for Interplay are very much in touch with what really makes these characters and makes Star Trek tick. I think I have had a very easy time performing the material because I get what they're after, because I think they understand how the characters work with each other and what the characters' functions are. They certainly have captured Spock's attitude, his speech, his precision of mind, his sense of humor, which is very important, big part of the character, his interaction with Kirk, his interaction with McCoy. So I would say if I had a chance to speak to all of them, congratulations. I think they've done a great job.